kill other animals is a part of this evolution?
Yeah, that's a good question. All things, all sentient life forms are conscious. Like I said, a clam's conscious, right? So the problem is when you eat a clam, you're eating a conscious entity, okay? If you look at an ethical problem of free will, it has to do with you imposing your free will on another's free will. In that case, you would come to an ethical conclusion that it was unethical to impose, you know, if you kill something, it's kind of imposing your will, right? You're ending its free will. That would support vegetarianism. I think that's fairly obvious thing. Now, on the other hand, you have a situation where if there's a necessity for one thing to live, to have to kill another, like we have, you know, lions, tigers, and bears, right? They kill to live. Okay, now that's a different situation. And people may be in that frame as well sometimes, particularly in the past. You know, hunters, gatherers, sometimes the hunting was better than the gathering, and it was kill or be killed sort of thing. So they would hunt, they would eat meat, and that would be good. There's no moral issue there. It's a matter of survival, where you have other choices is where the rub comes in. If you have other choices, you don't have to kill to survive or to eat or to be healthy, but you do anyway because you like it. Then that's not a moral choice. Okay. So that's the difference. Now, you know, there's another aspect to it besides the have to and not have to, and that is you have to look at the bigger picture of your surroundings, the people you're with, and what's going on. Now, I tend to come to the conclusion that you shouldn't come to any hard and fast rules about how to live and what to do, because there's usually exceptions that you have to work with. If you were in a situation where it would be impolite and unhelpful to not eat meat, then making a fuss over it might not be the best thing to do. It may be that you should swallow that and do it anyway, just because that would be better for all. If it's going to create more trouble than good, you might make an exception. On the other hand, if it's going to create more good than trouble, like you may help somebody else also gain your moral perspective, then it might be good, better than trouble. The point is, you have to come to each situation independently and decide whether it's a good thing to do. So as a vegetarian, I think you would be probably, you know, 99.99% of the time you could probably be a vegetarian and do it in good faith. There may be some occasions when that might not be appropriate. You know, it's a matter, you know, you'd hurt somebody else's feelings. There's also a third wrinkle, and that is you don't necessarily have to contribute to the slaughter of animals if you eat meat. You're thinking, well, no, how is that? Well, think of a scavenger. Okay, a scavenger eats meat, but it doesn't kill anything. It finds dead animals, right? It eats them. Okay, it's not contributing to the killing. And we as people can be scavengers as well, in the same way. So let's say you are invited to your office party every Christmas, and every Christmas this office party has, you know, ham and meat and shrimp and all kinds of things, and they always buy the same amount. You know, they always buy, you know, 100 pieces of this and 500 pieces of that, and they put it out on the tables and people wander around and eat, you know, a typical Christmas party. Now, whether you eat that meat or avoid it will make no difference to any animal being killed. It's already purchased. That's what they're going to buy. If you eat it, they're not going to buy more next year. It's just the way it is. Or if you're dining with somebody and they order something with meat and they don't finish it all, and you go, oh, well, you know, I'm still hungry, and you eat that meat, you didn't contribute to that, you know, animal's death or anything. So that's being a scavenger. You know, that's you, the buzzard. You know, eating meat that you just happen to find already dead. So there are all these little, you know, nuances and nooks and crannies in vegetarianism. But fundamentally, you're right. Killing things because you don't have to, killing other conscious beings just because it pleases you, is not very, what should we say, respectful to their free will. So, but there are ways, there are exceptions for several reasons, and I would say that it's probably dysfunctional to make hard and set rules for yourself that apply always. You know, personally, I tend to avoid meat most of the time, but sometimes it's impractical, so I've been the other way. And it's a lot of the times I'm a vulture, and I scavenge meat that somebody else killed. The idea that something would incarnate just because it wanted to be eaten, I think, is kind of a big stretch of an assumption. Animals tend to have what sometimes is called group soul. And it's basically, they have a non-physical part, but it's not as differentiated as ours because it's not as intellectual. It doesn't have as what I call decision space. What decision space is your, what is your ability? How many decisions can you make? What decisions do you have? That's your decision space. Okay, now humans have a lot of decision space, some more than others. The more you grow, the lower your entropy, the bigger your decision space. There's more things that you can decide. The smaller your reality, the smaller your decision space. A dog has less decisions than it can make than a person. Its decision space is smaller. Decision space is kind of a measure of your reality. It's how much you interact with that reality. Well, you get down, you know, to a chicken, and a chicken has even less decision space. It's just, it can still make decisions, but they're fewer. A clam has even fewer than that. You know, it has very few decisions, and sometimes those decisions are pretty much hardwired, but they're not entirely hardwired. There's some aspect that the clam has to decide whether it pulls its foot in or whether it doesn't. You know, whether it does its thing, it does the mate, or whether it doesn't. And by the hardwire, sometimes they just do that reflexively, but there's also some tiny little bit of consciousness involved there if they're sentient, if they're really sentient. Not all things that react aren't necessarily sentient, but anyway, so everything has consciousness. Everything that has consciousness has a soul. It's all in the progress, it's all in the process of evolving, just as we are. But where you have very little decision space, you have very little differentiation. You know, one clam is sort of like the other. So in this kind of a group soul thing, a cow, you know, a food animal, a chicken, just, you know, reincarnates, as you say, is born into this and dies, but this is part of the group soul. So they don't really come in wishing to be food. They just come in because they're in, and part of that is just experience, and that's where they are. That's the kind of critter they are. So they come in and they experience. They also have choices if they have any decisions at all. That means they have choices. If they have choices, they have good choices and bad choices. The good choices cause them to evolve. So we kind of jump into their game by domesticating them and then slaughtering them for food. That's kind of pushing our will, you know, over their will. So it's a thing to think about. You know, it is a moral, vegetarianism and eating animals is a moral issue, but I wouldn't get so far as to say it's 100% and never do this or always do that. Never and always are usually words that don't work.